The next speaker is Pedro Ide. If you could come up. He will speak to us on surveillance to direct interventions and challenges to measurement in the field.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be speaking about surveillance to direct interventions and on some challenges for measurements in the field. And I will start by quoting Pedro Alonso, who normally says that surveillance is our vaccine, and nothing's more than true if we believe that by doing surveillance, we'll be able to know what's happening and also to respond to what's happening. So as a vaccine, HATS actually. I'll be back to the routine surveillance system in Mozambique, how it works. I know that most of you knows it, but let me just go back on it, especially because we start at the level of each health facility or community health workers who currently are reporting through paper forms by aggregating monthly data that are sent then to the district level, where this information is entered into the DHIS2 system and then used at the national level and also back to the district level. In some areas in southern Mozambique, we have started expanding this system to the level of health facilities. So each health facilities and community health workers are reporting directly into the DHIS2 system. And in a very special, in one district, I mean, in southern Mozambique, where we are implementing also some of elimination activities, we have expanded furthermore, especially the frequency of reporting to a weekly based reporting that allow us to respond on a quicker manner to the incidental cases that are happening. This is the type of data that is collected not only in Mozambique, but everywhere. We are collecting data for under 5 and for above 5 years age groups. We are taking all total outpatient visits, the total number of RDTs, the total positives, and suspected malaria cases. You can admire why we're taking suspected malaria cases, where when we are saying that everyone should be tested and treated accordingly to the result of the testing, but this is not normal the case, and in some instances, for instance, there is a stuck ruptures on either ACTs or the testing, and we're still collecting some suspected malaria cases, and also treatment provided. This data can be used for stratify areas in hazards as well as districts according to the level of transmission, also to monitor and evaluate the interventions that are being performed, as well as to use the same surveillance as an intervention to guide some responses. But there are still a lot of challenges for having accurate incident estimates, especially linked to the denominators. I think that you all know that most of the denominators used here are coming from national census that are not always updated, at least in the frequency that we would like to have this data to use. And there are several ways of, and also for instance, for the numerators that are depending also for several factors, like, for instance, a varying health-seeking behavior, the quality of care at each health facility or community health worker, and also from the quality of the reported data. Most of these numerators are corrected by using data coming from the DHIS surveys or malaria indicator surveys, and also from the quality of data from performing data quality audits regularly. There are also other approaches. Some of them have been mentioned here. For instance, estimating denominators through modeling from using mobility data or other source of data, also modeling care-seeking behavior by using the distance to health facilities or community health workers. How surveillance can be used as intervention? Well, we can respond to a case or a group of cases that are reported by our surveillance system by different manners, for instance, doing focal investigation, focal MDAs, or focal IRS, depending on the case or on the situation. I'll be focusing in the focal mass drug administration that we are doing in Mozambique as a response to the case that are detected through the surveillance, the routine surveillance system. We are doing a reactive focal mass drug administration since July 2017 on top of universal IRS coverage and also LLN distribution that also occurred over during these 2 years ago. And in this system, all index cases are followed by a field worker to the household within 48 to 72 hours, and we do provide treatment to all household residents, household members, residents of the index case case with DHA PIP, and regardless of the result of the testing. That's done only for research purposes in this case. And some preliminary data coming from our work, for instance, says that we have been able to follow up to more than 8% of the index cases, and the coverage is also above 8% of the contacts of those index cases. But there are still some challenges on that front. For instance, it's hard to find very young index cases to be located in the community. And there are also some people who are coming from other districts to the one where we are working, and then they leave. So when we go to the community, we cannot find them, of course, because they do not live on that area. There are some issues with the collaboration with some health facilities and community health workers that are easy to solve, but it's not always the case, depending on the personality or sometimes on the support from the local health authorities. And it's especially difficult to find some young working men and travelers at home, especially during the day. And there are some issues on logistics, mostly linked to transport and other needs to allow us to be able to follow and find most of the index cases as well as their contacts. Some preliminary data coming from these systems indicate that, for instance, for the clinical malaria incidence as well as malaria prevalence, we did initially, over the past 3 years, 2 rounds of MDA plus indoor residual spraying, and after that, we started with the reactive case investigation. So from the before and after comparisons, we have seen a 63% reduction in case incidents after the first transmission season post the MDAs. And in terms of prevalence, we have seen also a reduction of about 50% from year to year of malaria prevalence using rapid RDTs, rapid diagnosis tests, in this area during the same period. Another component that's normally neglected, I will say, is the entomological surveillance. Although we do know that this is critical for the selection of vector control strategies and also to monitor their effectiveness and impact. although we do recognize that the way it's done right now is difficult to standardize among different countries due to different environments and question asked. And we know that there is a work ongoing on the minimal essential data or indicators that could be used to guide programmatic questions and also to evaluate programmatic decisions. In Mozambique, in southern Mozambique, there is an ongoing project that's trying to ask if, for instance, indoor residual spraying could be effectively applied in the areas that are not applied right now. And just as an example of that, we've been, just by changing the way we are collecting the data, focusing not only to the indoor biting, but also to the outdoor biting mosquitoes, we are seeing some primary vectors that are indoor and outdoor, especially Gambia. There are several potential other vectors that are acting both indoor and outdoor. We are seeing also more outdoor biting Gambia, especially after the initial rounds of IRS. And also there are few indoor resting mosquitoes. So, posing a question of effectiveness of applying IRS in this area. So this type of information, if standardized and applied on a more concrete manner, can help the programs to guide most of these interventions. This is the type of questions that most of the programs are challenging with. So in conclusion, just let me say that EPI and ENTO surveillance should be the backbone of any endemic country. In order to design effective strategies and evaluate them, some countries like Mozambique have come a long way in the past few years, driven by WHO recommendations and partner support. And as it has been said here, surveillance doesn't need to be so complicated to guide most of the interventions needed. And at very low transmission levels, we do realize that accurate and more frequent reported surveillance data becomes more critical and can also be used as an intervention through triggering action into the communities, and although more, some evidence is needed on this field. Let me thank you.
I also want to mention something I neglected to say in the introduction, that Pedro Ida is the first Alan J. McGill Fellow, and he is doing this at the end of his first year. So congratulations, and thank you very much.